Welcome to the worship service of the First Baptist Church of Middletown, Kentucky. My name is Jim Cobbin, and I'm the pastor here at the First Baptist Church. We are honored that you're spending these few moments with us, turning our hearts toward the Lord. We invite you to pray with us, sing with us, open your Bible and read along with us. Our prayer is that you will experience God's Holy Spirit that will speak to you and nourish you, give you comfort and strength. Between now and Easter, we're in the Gospels every Sunday. We're looking at people who follow Jesus. Today, in our Gospel reading, Jesus calls his first four disciples in Mark's telling. We are all being called to follow Jesus. Let's see what the scripture has for us today. I invite you to pray with me. Loving God, how grateful we are for your love and mercy that comes so richly toward us. We come confessing that we are not yet the people you created us to be. We're truly sorry for those moments when we have failed you. We ask for your forgiveness, O God. Our Father, we ask you to come and speak to us. Receive our prayers and our offerings and our singing as our sacrifice to you. We ask you to speak to us, so that we may hear, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Join me in singing this great song of praise, Majesty, followed by I Am Resolved No Longer to Linger. Worship His Majesty.
I'll be reading from Mark chapter 1. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little further, he saw James and the son of Zebedee and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men, and they followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We're back in the Gospel of Mark today. 2 weeks ago, we started our journey through Mark, and I said to you then that in Mark there is always a sense of urgency. One of his favorite words is immediately. And I said to you 2 weeks ago that there was an urgency among Mark's first readers. They were the Christians in Rome who were being persecuted by Nero. The church was at risk, and these folks were needing a message from Jesus. And so Mark comes to us to say, Jesus is moving with urgency, with speed. Jesus has not left you, but that Jesus is creating God's kingdom here on earth. Today in our text, we will read of Jesus calling two brothers, two sets of brothers, Peter and Andrew, and James and John. Jesus was in the Galilee. That's up in the northern region. You'd love the Galilee. It's beautiful. It's green and lush in the spring, a little dry in the summer, but it's seasonal. Leaves actually fall from the trees. But there are palm trees too. It looks a little bit to me like North Florida. It's beautiful, but with a lot of water in the northern part of the Galilee. Jesus is walking along the edge of the water. So who would you run into along the edge of the water than two sets of brothers who are fishermen? Fishing was a major industry in ancient days, and until very recently, still a major industry. The Sea of Galilee has been overfished, and so right now there's a moratorium or a limit on the number of fish that can be taken out of the Sea of Galilee. But it will rebound. It's a body of fresh water that's 8 miles wide and 13 miles long. It looks a little bit like a harp. And that how it got one of its names, Gennesaret, the Sea of Gennesaret, the harp-shaped sea. It's also called in the Bible the Sea of Tiberias because the Romans built a major city there on the eastern shore, the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. We have no record that Jesus ever went into Tiberias. It was a Roman city built on a cemetery, and devout Jews wouldn't go there. But Jesus was all around the lake. There in the lake, they fished for sardines. Very popular, and that fish would be salted and served and kept year-round, as well as tilapia. In fact, there is a tilapia fish that is found there that's called St. Peter's fish, because in the Gospel of Matthew it says that Peter caught a fish and in its mouth was a gold coin, and it was used to pay the temple tax for Jesus. So today, when you go to modern Israel, we always have lunch on the shore of the Sea of Galilee of a whole tilapia, if you don't mind your lunch staring back at you. It's delicious. And usually someone at the table will get a shekel in the mouth of the fish that they eat. Just a little fun thing that we do there. Somewhere on that northern shore is the town of Capernaum, a pretty good sized town, 1,500 or so, a profitable town. One of the reasons it's wealthy is that it is a stop on the Via Maris, on the highway that goes from Egypt to Damascus. That meant that it was a good place to collect taxes. So there were Gentiles living there who worked for the Roman government, as well as Jews who lived in Capernaum. We know that Simon Peter lived in Capernaum. Even though his hometown is Bethsaida, 10, 15 miles away, Capernaum is where Peter made his home. And we can assume there is where Peter and Andrew and James and John had their fishing businesses. Don't think of these fishermen as poor. These guys were wealthy enough to have a business, you heard in the text, that they had servants to help them to do the work, paid servants. These are not slaves, paid servants. And so fishing was a lucrative industry. Fishing was done then exactly how it's done now commercially in the Sea of Galilee, by drop nets, weighted nets that are thrown over from the boat, make a large circle, and as that net, it's weighted on the edges, as that net falls to the bottom, it snags fish. And then you drag those fish in, and those fish are not going willingly. They're flopping around. And so the fins of the fish are caught in the nets. Well, that's how you catch the fish. And you pull them into the boat or you pull them up on shore and you work those fish out of the nets. But those fins cut the nets. They used linen in the days of the New Testament. Now, those nets had to be constantly mended. So a fisherman When he wasn't fishing, he was mending. That's the world that these four brothers lived in as Jesus comes around and comes up to them. You have to wonder about these four fishermen. Did they love their work? Were they ready for a change? Two of these brothers are James and John. Jesus has another name, Boanerges, for them. Sons of Thunder. You have to wonder how these guys, these two brothers, got their names. That we know their father was Zebedee, and their mother probably was Salome, who was one of the women who were witness to the resurrection. But these two guys, were they always wrestling? Were they noisy and boisterous? Were they the center of every party? Jesus called them sons of thunder. The other two were Simon Peter and Andrew. We met them last week. Jesus comes to Peter and Andrew first, and he says, "Follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of people." Follow me. Mark says Peter and Andrew immediately followed Jesus. Why did they walk away? It raises questions. What about their wives and their children? What about their businesses they left behind? What about going and tying up loose ends and then meeting Jesus a week from Friday? That's not the picture the gospel gives us. Peter and Andrew immediately dropped their nets to follow Jesus. You hear that word immediately? Urgency. Then Jesus comes to James and John, the sons of thunder. And they immediately follow Jesus, and they leave their father and the servants in the boats mending their nets. What about their wives and kids? What about their businesses, the contracts they had to provide the fish? You see the urgency? It's time, right now, to follow Jesus. I want to focus for a few minutes on this word of Jesus to Peter and to Andrew, and I will make you to become fishers of people. Now, how that's constructed is very, very important, because Jesus does not say, I'm going to show you how to go fish for people. I am going to add fishing for people to your repertoire of your opportunities, of the things you know how to do. Jesus doesn't say that at all. I am going to change your identity so that at your core, you are someone who looks for people to invite into the kingdom. Isn't that an interesting word for us in being witnesses for the gospel? Being a witness for Jesus is not one of the things that we put on our resume that we know how to do. I can't tell you how many witness training seminars. I have memorized stacks of scripture. None of that was wrong. But that didn't make me to become a fisherman. It taught me how to fish for people. But it didn't change my core identity. Jesus changes who they are at their very heart. Because from then on, they are people who draw others to Jesus. As I said to you last week, we find Andrew doing that all the time. three times in the Gospel of John, Andrew is bringing someone to Jesus. Some of you are school teachers. Now, you went to school to learn how to be a school teacher, but what happened is you were transformed into your core identity at your heart. You're a school teacher. And whether you're in a classroom, or whether you're volunteering at the church, or whether you're working with your grandchild, at your core identity, you're a teacher. Jesus says, I'm not giving you a skill. I'm giving you a new life. Jesus can cause some real indigestion at this point. Because not all of us want this new life. It's tempting to say, oh, that's okay. I'm really happy with the way my life is right now. But without hesitance, Peter and Andrew, James and John turn away from who they were and embrace who Jesus is making them to become. They were ready to put away the regular life and take on this new life. See, Jesus is not calling them to heroics. I'm going to put you through a 4-year seminar and you will be the most highly trained fisherman for people you've ever met in your life. Jesus says, I'm going to change who you are so that at your core, you are looking for the lost people of the world. Jesus is claiming and transforming what was past into something new. Why would we do that? Why would we say to Jesus, okay, I'm ready to set aside where I've been, what I've done, who I am, and I'm ready to embrace this new person who is one who is looking for the lost and inviting them to new life in Christ? How many times a week do you get a call offering you the opportunity to purchase an extended warranty on your car? I've often laughed about thinking about the poor guy who's gone to jail and he gets to take one phone call. And that one phone call is not his lawyer or his wife. That one phone call is, we've been looking for you to talk to you about your extended warranty. You think, is following Jesus just picking up an extended warranty? Okay, I'm buying some fire insurance here so that when I die, I am not going down there. I'm just going to cover my warranty. Or is following Jesus saying, I am ready for a change of life. And from this point on, I am one who follows Jesus and looks for the lost. Are you discouraged in your struggle? Have you had moments where you follow Jesus so closely and you are an active witness? You're telling everyone you know. You're inviting people into a relationship with Jesus. And then you fall down. You lose faith, you lose heart, you lose hope. I want to remind you of something from Peter's life. Now, this story of Jesus meeting Peter on the shore of the Sea of Galilee happens very early, and we're still in the first chapter of Mark's gospel. And then 3 years of walking with Jesus and following Jesus. 3 years of being Jesus' daily disciple. Jesus is arrested in Jerusalem, and we know that story of Peter who denies knowing Jesus 3 times. John tells us in his gospel that after the crucifixion and the resurrection, Peter was lost. And he went back to his old self. In the 21st chapter of John, Jesus shows up again on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. This is after the resurrection. Jesus is on the shore cooking breakfast. Fish, of course. Peter is out in a boat going back to fishing. When Peter recognizes Jesus, he jumps out of the boat and swims to shore. Jesus and Peter have an interesting conversation. Look at chapter 21 in John's gospel and you'll see this encounter. But the conversation ends with Jesus saying to Peter, "Follow me." I have to wonder if it's the same spot that Jesus said it to Peter 3 years prior. In those 3 years, Peter had wavered all over the place. And here Jesus says it again, reminds Peter, "Follow me." Peter didn't get it right always, and neither will we. But our new identity as a follower of Jesus who fishes for people never leaves us. Let God work that work in you. Consider walking away from your old life and embracing the new identity Jesus offers. Amen.
Work for our good, though sometimes we can't see how they could. Struggles that break our hearts in two sometimes blind us to the truth. Our Father knows what's best for us. His ways are not our own. So when your pathway grows dim and you just can't see him, remember you're never alone. God is too to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see his plan, when you can't trace his hand, trust his heart. Sees the master plan, and he holds the future in his hands. sins. So don't live as those who have no hope. All our hope is found in Him. While we see the present clearly, He sees the first and the last, and like a tapestry, He's weaving you and me to one day be just like Him. God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. He alone is faithful and true. He alone knows what is best for you. God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. When you can't trace His hand, trust His heart, trust His heart.
Thank you for joining with us for this time of worship. We hope that you were renewed and encouraged today in your walk with Jesus. I want to remind you that we are meeting for in-person worship on Sunday mornings at 11. We've not yet added Sunday school. We are worshiping briefly, 45-minute services at 11 o'clock on Sunday mornings. We invite you to join us. I also want to invite you to consider making a decision to follow Jesus. Maybe for the very first time, you've never opened your heart. You've never said to Jesus, I'm ready to follow. Made your lifetime commitment to Jesus. I'd love to have a conversation with you about that. Call me at 502-245-7889, and we'll schedule a time to have that conversation. I also want to invite you to consider uniting with the church, becoming a member of First Baptist Church. Now, we're not having the traditional invitation right now. We're not walking the aisle. We're doing things very differently. It starts with a conversation that you and I will have, and then presenting you to the church. If you're not a person who wants to stand in front of the church and shake hands, this time is for you, because we are not doing that. We are welcoming you into the church from a safe distance, but making you a full partner in the work of God here in Middletown. Don't hesitate to call. I'd love to hear from you. Pray with me. Yes, Lord, we will follow you. Change who we are, so that at our very core, we are looking for others who are looking for you. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen.